Chapter 24, we'll start looking at carbonyl condensation reactions, and these are a little bit more complex looking. But we'll build on the things that we learned in chapter 23. We form an enolate by deprotonating alpha to a carbonyl. And in the last chapter, we would have the electron pair would come back down to reform the carbonyl, and this electron pair would come out and react either with a halogen or with an alkyl halide or something like that. But the same type of thing can happen between two carbonyl compounds. So if we have one enolate, this electron pair can come back, and this electron pair goes out to react. And so we get back to the standard question that I always ask you, who has electrons and who wants them? So hopefully you can already see that the enolate is going to be who has electrons. So as these electrons come out, so this is our nucleophile, then you want to look at your other carbonyl compound and decide, where is my electrophile? And hopefully that's a really obvious question by now too, because it's going to be at the carbonyl carbon. It has a big delta plus. Carbonyl oxygen has a delta minus. This electron pair then would go out on oxygen. The biggest challenge in these reactions, I think, actually is not figuring out what should happen as far as how the electrons move, but it's drawing the product afterwards. So if I redraw that, so here's the carbonyl I reformed. Here's the atom that now added to the carbonyl. So that's this atom right here, added to a carbonyl. So that carbonyl has got an O minus now. And what else was there? There was a methyl and another methyl. So I need to draw a methyl and another methyl on that place that it added. And even though this mechanism isn't quite done, that's the type of mechanism that we're going to be seeing in this chapter. Really, the only part that's missing then is that at some point we need to reprotonate this. So if I bring water along or something else that's like a polar protic solvent, I can reprotonate this alkoxide to make an alcohol. So, and this reaction is called the Aldol reaction. And this is not somebody's name now, but it's named because if this were an aldehyde, I made one with a ketone, for example, but we'd have an ald, and then we have an alcohol, an ol. So whether it's an aldehyde or a ketone here, we still call it Aldol. So it's an Aldol type reaction. And another way that we can name our Aldol product, we have our carbonyl here, and then this is the alpha position of the carbonyl, this is the beta position of the carbonyl. So I can also name my molecule, or my type of molecule, as a beta hydroxy carbonyl. In this case, it would be a beta hydroxy ketone. We could also have a beta hydroxyaldehyde. And since I would expect that you would probably need to see this reaction several times, we can do another example of it. But let's start at the beginning. So I have an aldehyde. I'm going to treat that with some kind of a strong base. Now the strong base might be anything from hydroxide up to something more like LDA, something like that. That's going to be very strong and deprotonate. So we need to take off the alpha proton with our strong base. So our strong base, or hydroxide, or whatever, will come by. I'll draw in my alpha proton that's not drawn in. Remove that proton. The electron pair will go up here. This electron pair from the carbonyl will go up to make my enolate. Okay, and so now that I have an enolate, now I have nothing left to react with except another molecule of the aldehyde. So now if this electron pair comes back down, the electron pair from the alkene of the enolate comes out, who has electrons and who wants them, to the carbonyl carbon of another aldehyde, pushing the electron pair from the carbonyl pi bond up onto oxygen. All right, and once again, and this time I'm going to draw with different colors to kind of help point out what's going on better. So that's my original aldehyde that's reformed. The rest of it I'm going to draw in blue. So this electron pair comes back down to reform this carbonyl right here. This electron pair comes out and it attaches to this carbonyl carbon from that one. So this carbon is the one right here. Okay. The carbonyl carbon is the next one. And that's got an oxygen on it with O minus. And then I look at what else is on that carbon. There's one CH3 and there's a hydrogen. So that was from my second molecule. Then the last thing is to reprotonate. And there I have my aldol product. And you notice there are two carbons from one acetaldehyde that we used to make it, and there are two carbons from the second acetaldehyde to make it. So a key way to count it at the end is to look at how many carbons you have in your starting material. Here I've got one, two carbons in the starting material. And since I'm condensing two molecules of the acetaldehyde together, I don't have anywhere that I lose carbons. I should have one, two, three, four carbons in my product. Now there's a sometimes unintended reaction that also can occur. Sometimes we want this reaction to happen, and other times we might not. So if we leave the base in there long enough, after we've formed our beta hydroxy carbonyl, we can actually deprotonate here, which can cause the hydroxide to leave. And if we do that, we end up with an alpha-beta unsaturated carbonyl. And this is really stable. And the reason that this is really stable is because, again, we have conjugation. We've got one, two, three, four atoms in a row that are all sp2 hybridized, all have pi bonds, and all have electrons in p orbitals. This is fully conjugated through here. And since we have this conjugation, it's going to be lower energy. That's what makes this proton pretty acidic, because it's easy to pull off because it leads to a low energy product.